Last week, we saw a five-term U.S. senator lose in his state's primary, a two-term senator get forced into election overtime in hers, and the Tea Party score a major victory in Kentucky. This morning, Meet the Press moderator David Gregory joins us live from Washington, D.C. David, good morning to you. No bigger win Tuesday than that of Democratic Congressman Joe Sestak over incumbent Arlen Specter. What will we learn about him when he's on your program later this morning? And is he now considered the favorite in Pennsylvania?
Well, it's going to be a tough race, and I think you get different answers to that question. I think a lot of people think he's in for a pretty tough race. He's running as an outsider, but he's a U.S. congressman, so I think it's going to be a challenge to see how he sort of stands by the president. He's voted with him, how he stands by him, but also runs as a Washington outsider. I think the other big story, of course, was Kentucky, and you're seeing this Tea Party conservative movement really flex its muscles now around the issue of the deficit and spending, although Dr. Rand Paul has had a pretty rough week here, getting far from that message and talking about the limits of government elsewhere and civil rights. But I think that this issue of what's happening on the right and this reaction to government spending is going to be a lot of kindling, a lot of fuel for the November race.
Certainly, and I did want to talk a little bit more about that Kentucky race and about Rand Paul. He was supposed to be on Meet the Press today, but according to the website, canceled yesterday, or it might have been Friday. What do we know about that, and any plans to get him on the program in the near future?
Well, we'd like to have that. We would have liked to have asked him some questions this morning, but he did cancel on Friday after a pretty rough week. He indicated that he didn't want to answer any more questions about his stand on civil rights. He felt he'd answered all of that. But, of course, there were other questions beyond just his views on that. And I think it's pretty clear, and there's reporting on this, that senior Republicans had said to him it was time to start avoiding the national spotlight because he was weakening his own candidacy. So I think he looked pretty strong. On Tuesday, I think in the days since, he's demonstrated that he's got rather extreme views that are outside the mainstream of the Republican Party. How that serves him in Kentucky, we don't know yet. He looks to be in pretty good position right now against his opponent, his Democratic opponent, and he is riding a wave of this anti-Washington anger right now.
Certainly. Now, Rand Paul, in his defense, has said this sort of whole story about his comments regarding the Civil Rights Act of 1964 was manufactured by, and I'm quoting here, the loony left. How much do you think this story sticks with him? Is this something he'll be able to shed? Does this go away in a couple of weeks, or is this going to dog him for the next few months, do you think?
You know, I just think at some point you have to say that, you know, you got to call spin what it is. I mean, that is spin from him. The notion that the loony left is pressing him on issues of the limits of government, when this is the soul of his candidacy. He believes that government ought to be small, so small, in fact, that his views about civil rights are that there one title of the Civil Rights Act should not apply to private businesses. Now, this is not something that he was ambushed about. He has got pretty wide, you know, deeply held views about this. He's quite articulate about it. He's thought about all of these things. So I think this is the kind of thing that candidates should be vetted on. The notion that this is some sort of creation. If you have a candidate running against Washington who wants smaller government, I think it's totally appropriate to ask him about what the limits of government actually should be, what the scope of government should be. These are absolutely relevant to his candidacy. So he's doing what politicians do. He'll start to attack the media and dismiss it as bias. But I think it's his articulation of his own views that many in his own party, not just the left, felt were way too extreme to the point where they said he ought to stop talking.
Interesting, to say the least. I want to go back to the incumbency challenge. You and I have been talking about this for the last few weeks here, specifically in North Carolina. We have a Republican incumbent, Richard Burr, up for re-election in November. We have about 15, 20 seconds left. Do you think incumbents everywhere were watching closely what happened Tuesday in Pennsylvania and Arkansas and are perhaps a little bit more nervous than they might have been going into November?
I think incumbents have been worried all along the way. I mean, if voters are unhappy with Washington, they don't like the direction of the country, you got unemployment near 10%. That's all you need to know. If you're an incumbent, it's not a good time to be sitting here in Washington when people hold those views.
David, we appreciate your time and expertise. As always, David Gregory, moderator of Meet the Press. And, of course, we'll be watching at 9 o'clock when the show begins right here on WXII.